Shivachayai Namah. Om Sri Sarasvatiyai Namah. Om Sri Guru Charna Kamale Vyo Namo Namah.
Namaskar. Welcome to our series of discussions on the fundamentals of Hinduism. Hinduism is the oldest religion in the world, and many may contest this statement. However, the facts speak for themselves. India itself has a vast diversity of faith practices, but it culminates into one way of thinking that there is only one religion. And today, for lack of a better term, we use the word Hinduism. In reality, this term Hinduism was not something that came from the Hindu texts or Hindu scriptures. They are terminology that was handed or designated to people from that part of the world by foreigners. To be exact, people who lived in the Hindu Kush mountain range were called Hindus, and their religion became Hinduism. We of Indian origin have accepted this terminology and continue to live with it. But if one was to ask for the true statement or a name or a declaration of what this way of life is, it will be Satya Sanatan Dharma. It is this Satya Sanatan Dharma, or this divine way of living, or the divine laws of God that we live by, that what Hinduism is based upon and built upon. As such, it is fair to say that Hinduism is not a religion. It is not founded by an individual. It's not named after another person. It is not named after a country. It is really a process that has been given a title, that this is the way to live and relate with God. Thus, Satya Sanatan Dharma is the title I will use going forward whenever practical. For our discussion today, I want to address the concept of the many God theory that in Hindus are accused of worshipping, and that we worship idols. First, Hinduism is a monotheistic religion, only one God. But we have a polytheistic view of that one God. We see every attribute of human existence, need, desire, necessity, to be a form or aspect of God, because we believe that God is everything and everything is God. So we cannot escape the relationship with God. Thus, we label or we identify and we give a title and a name to an entity or a substance or a concept, all names to help us to relate. Thus, amongst all of these deities, and I will try to avoid in all our discussions using the term God and gods, because this is a Western concept. The minute we hear gods, we think plural. So we'll say a deity, which in my understanding is a definition of a divine attribute. A deity, and the first deity we contemplate in our way of life, is a deity we call Ganesh. And the classic is Om Sri Ganeshaya Namah. And the appearance of this deity and his presentation are many forms. We must not get focused on the form itself. We must get focused on what the form represents. It's like I'm looking at a printed circuit board, and it's ugly looking. It has resistors and capacitors and all kinds of things, but that's not what it's about. It's the ability that it has to communicate and to connect with a satellite in the heavens and to connect with my cell phone that's 1,000 miles away. Its appearance is insignificant to its capabilities and qualities. As such, the appearance of Ganesh in my mind is secondary to what he represents. For he represents the focus of our faculties, our sense faculties. When we start in any endeavor, it is suggested that we try to bring all our faculties together. We bring all our senses, sight, hearing, smell, taste, and touch, to focus on that specific objective. The example, if I'm about to have a meal, in order for me to consume this meal well, and to have my digestive system work on it, and for me to get the best results of this meal, if all of my faculties are focused on that objective and consuming that meal, I will get 100% result. But if I'm watching television while I'm eating, or I'm having a conversation on the phone while I'm eating, or I'm reading a newspaper, I am definitely not 100% focused on consuming the meal. Thus, I might get upset stomach, burned stomach, acid indigestion, and all of these negative impacts. Similarly, If we are not focused on the objective of contemplating our studies, doing with our job, relating to God, with tan or man arpan, body and mind focus, then we do not get 100% benefit. Thus, Ganesh is Pratama Dhyan, the first deity we contemplate, saying, "Oh God, help me to focus my mind." Thus, here's a simple example of how important it is to have a specific attribute that we relate to for a specific purpose of bringing the mind and the faculties together. Thus, the concept of many gods is truly an ignorant approach to understanding Hinduism. For the more one understands this way of life, one will see that there is only one God. Having accepted that there is only one God, we proceed to look at this way of life. In the world we live in today, our lifestyle determines who we are. All the scientists, the clinical advice, the theological advice, the philosopher's advice, the dietitian advice is saying, change your lifestyle, moderate lifestyle, modify your lifestyle, for lifestyle is makes you who you are. Hinduism, from the beginning, was all about lifestyle. For Hinduism, it's a way of life. So, live your life in a positive way. It says, love, care, compassion, forgive, and interact with all of God's creation as a privilege in service to God. When one accepts a simple approach to dealing with God and relating with God, then one sees that one doesn't have to be a special character. One doesn't have to be academically well endowed, physically endowed, or financially endowed to relate to God. Our financial status, our physical prowess, our academic knowledge has no significance on how we relate to God. It's our inner feeling and the way we interact with the world around us that makes us relate to God or not relate to God. Thus, way of life, lifestyle changes is what Hinduism is all about. And this brings it to the forefront of the world today, making it a universal way of living, because every human being is faced with the challenge of how do I live so I can get the best out of my life. And when we ask the question, then we revert back to the basics of life. I must rest properly. I must eat properly. I must exercise properly. I must think positively. These are the basics of every human being in order to create a positive lifestyle. For if we sleep well, we reduce stress. If we eat well, we reduce stress. If we exercise well, we reduce stress. If we meditate, we reduce stress. For the world that we live in, it's a stressful world. Hinduism is the answer to reducing stress. And it's not a clinical solution. It's a practical and simplistic solution that everyone can follow. Thus, in the fundamentals of Hinduism, one must look at one's life and ask the question, what is it to be Hindu? What does it take? For a Hindu, it's a question to ask for a non-Hindu. The realities are there is no conversion process. You may be born in a Hindu home. If you do not follow the way of life, then you are not following the way of life. You don't lose status as a Hindu. And if you are not born in a Hindu home and you follow the Hindu way of life, you acquire status as a Hindu. Hinduism does not excommunicate anyone or toss someone out of this way of thinking, because you either have a negative status or a positive status, but you have status. You never lose status. So once a Hindu, always a Hindu, and if you accept it, then you are doing well. So we want to come to a closure at this point whereby we talked about the Hindu way of life is a simplistic way of life that fundamentally is the basics for all humanity to follow in order to get the best result out of their existence in this world. Om Shanti, Shanti.